we can start also today. That is on May 2020. So we need to continue to work to talk about the estimation of the design discharge. We need to talk about the design water discharge. Actually, we have said last lessons that we need to separate the two problems. The first one is to estimate the water discharge in terms of its maximum value. Indeed, if you think about the behavior of the water discharge during a rainfall event, you can realize that the hydrograph is not characterized by a constant value, but the water discharge first increases and then decreases. Then we can identify a maximum value of the water discharge, and we can call this one Q max. But also we could be interested in the temporal variation of the water discharge. So we need to face both the problem. The first one is to estimate the value of the maximum water discharge flowing in the river or in the channel we are designing, but also to compute, to estimate the temporal variation of the water discharge itself. And in both cases, we need to start from a latent period, and then we need to estimate all the maximum value of the water discharge or the temporal variation of the water discharge itself. The last time we observed that in a very general approach, the water discharge is a volume over a time. So this is a kind proportional, of course, to a net volume over a time. We can write it as a T star. So we need to get an estimation of both the net volume that is available to the runoff. So this is the volume available to the runoff, but also a time needed to the net volume to reach the downstream section of a watershed, of a catchment. So we can depict a watershed. So this is a land portion, watershed. So we need to identify a land portion that drains water coming from the sky to the hydrologic network. Then we can depict a kind of network that is able to convey the water to the downstream section. So this is the downstream section at which a water discharge is flowing. And here, just here, we can depict again the hydrograph. So of course, if it rains, we can depict in green. If it rains, so we can write it as ATD power N. So this is our design rainfall. We need to identify the net volume, so the portion of the rainfall depth, the rainfall volume that is available to the runoff, and then can be the estimation can be used to evaluate both the temporal variation of the water discharge, but in this case the maximum value of the water discharge itself. So we need to solve a series of problems. So first of all, we need to understand how we can estimate the value of the net volume, and then we need to define a kind of method in order to identify the time needed to this volume to reach the downstream section. And the last time we said that the net volume can be written as a coefficient that is lower than one that multiplied for the total volume can define the volume available to the runoff, and the total volume is actually the rainfall depth times the area of the watershed. Actually, we have said that this is an integral of the rainfall depth as a function of the location integrated over the whole watershed. So if this is X and this is Y, in which the watershed is delineated, then we can define a rainfall depth as a function of the location integrated over the whole area of the watershed. We get the total volume coming from the sky. Now, if the rainfall depth is constant along the whole watershed, this can be written as dH, the rainfall depth constant over the whole watershed, times the area. So this one can be defined by means of the rainfall depth, or better, the design rainfall depth. The area of the watershed can be estimated on the basis of the analysis of the topography, and then we can define the total volume. Pay attention that as this one is related to a given return period, also the total volume is related to the same given return period, and then also the net volume is related to the same time period, and then the water discharge is the same, as is related to the same return period. So we can depict this one here. Actually, phi is a number, is a coefficient that we can get from tables. So we have on one end the description of the land use, and on the other hand we can relate to each land use the correct number to use instead of phi. Actually, we have seen that also another method is possible. In this case, the net volume is written in terms of this S. S is the capability of the soil to receive water from the rainfall. So S is the quantity, the volume of water that is not available to the runoff. So in this case, we can write something like that. And S is written as 254 times 100 over a number that is called the card number. This is card number. that depends not only on the land use, but also on the hydrologic state of the soil. So we can discriminate, we can realize that with the same land use, different kind of soil, I mean if the soil is made of gravel or clay or silt, then the available volume to the runoff may change. So the curve number is related to both the land use but also on the hydrologic feature of the soil in terms of its capability to receive water from the rainfall. So also in this case Cn is a number, more or less from a conceptual point of view as phi, that we can get again from tables in which we have not only the land use but also the hydrologic feature of the soil. I just switch to Italian a little bit. Quindi per definire il valore della portata in maniera del tutto semplificata, se volete, osservando semplicemente quali sono le dimensioni di una portata, cioè una portata volumetrica del corpo, quindi un rapporto tra un volume e un tempo, abbiamo la necessità di definire da una parte un volume e dall'altra un tempo. L'altra volta abbiamo visto come è possibile definire questo cosiddetto volume netto. Il volume netto non coincide con quello che cade dal cielo, perché nella sostanza abbiamo visto che parte di quest'acqua viene o infiltrata nel terreno oppure torna all'atmosfera grazie, o meglio, a causa di una serie di fenomeni che non stiamo qui a descrivere nel dettaglio perché questo non è un corso di idrologia, ma in maniera del tutto intuitiva potete capire che non tutta l'acqua che cade dal cielo si trasforma in un deflusso, cioè va a finire nel reticolo idrografico, ma quello che succede è che una parte viene persa. E quindi è possibile riferirsi o ad un metodo che semplicemente si riferisce alla definizione di un coefficiente che abbiamo chiamato phi, un coefficiente di deflusso, runoff coefficient, che ovviamente inferiore all'unità, permette di definire qual è il volume netto, cioè quello che si trasforma in deflusso, in funzione del volume totale, cioè quello che arriva dal cielo. Ora, il volume totale, cioè quello che arriva dal cielo, è evidentemente legato alla legge di pioggia, alla pioggia di progetto che abbiamo già definito. E quindi può essere visto come l'integrale dell'altezza di pioggia, che vi ricordo è il volume per unità di superficie, integrato su tutto il bacino, watershed is bacino idrografico. Quindi, se la pioggia cambia a seconda del punto del bacino, ovviamente questo integrale è molto difficile da calcolare. Se però in prima approssimazione ipotizziamo che l'altezza di pioggia sia costante su tutto il bacino, allora semplicemente questo volume totale può essere calcolato come un'altezza di pioggia moltiplicato l'estensione del bacino. In realtà vi ho detto in maniera del tutto semplificata, in realtà se questa altezza di pioggia è la cosiddetta altezza di pioggia media o la guagliata, in realtà questo è esattamente vero. Cioè, calcolando il valore medio dell'altezza di pioggia possiamo calcolare direttamente questo volume totale. Quindi nell'utilizzare questa relazione abbiamo tutte le informazioni necessarie. Abbiamo il volume totale perché abbiamo la pioggia di progetto, abbiamo il valore di phi perché lo prendiamo da delle tabelle e quindi abbiamo il valore netto, o meglio il volume netto, e quindi abbiamo risolto, se volete, il numeratore di questa relazione. Ora vi faccio osservare che alla pioggia di progetto è associato un tempo di ritorno, cioè una sua probabilità di non superamento. Quindi vuol dire che questo tempo di ritorno è sicuramente associato al volume totale, ma in maniera un po' meno ovvia è ereditato dal volume netto e, come vedremo, questo volume netto trasferisce la sua informazione probabilistica anche alla portata. Quindi nella sostanza stiamo dicendo che il tempo di ritorno associato alla pioggia di progetto è lo stesso tempo di ritorno associato alla portata che stiamo stimando. In realtà abbiamo visto l'altra volta che questo non è l'unico metodo per calcolare il volume netto che ci serve per definire il valore massimo della portata, ma ne esiste anche un altro. Questo è il metodo SCS, il metodo SCS, in cui il volume netto viene calcolato, o meglio, stimato, ovviamente sempre in funzione del volume totale, e il volume totale lo possiamo calcolare in funzione della pioggia di progetto, ma anche in funzione di una capacità S. Vedete, questa S è sicuramente un volume, che è il volume che il suolo può trattenere, quindi una sorta di capacità del terreno di trattenere una quota parte del volume di acqua legato alla pioggia e quindi di sottrarlo al deflusso. E questo è del tutto intuitivo, quindi è proprio la definizione del volume netto, se volete. Il problema è stimare la capacità del suolo a trattenere acqua in termini di volumi, cioè in maniera quantitativa. E abbiamo visto che il metodo SCS fornisce anche questa relazione, e questa relazione definisce questa capacità del suolo S in funzione di un numero, di un coefficiente che si chiama count number, che ancora una volta può essere definito sulla base dell'utilizzo di valori tabellari. Però in questo caso nella tabella non c'è soltanto l'utilizzo del suolo, ma anche la cosiddetta classe idrologica. Quindi capite che se c'è un campo coltivato a cui il primo metodo associa un certo valore di φ, nell'ambito del metodo SCS è importante anche sapere qual è la composizione che influenza le caratteristiche idrologiche del suolo a trattenere quest'acqua. Vi sto dicendo nella sostanza che da un punto di vista della trasformazione a flussi deflussi, l'afflusso è la pioggia, il deflusso è la portata, è importante anche la tipologia di terreno. E quindi un campo coltivato sull'argilla, un campo coltivato sulla ghiaia, o sulla sabbia, diciamo così, avranno una capacità di intrattenere l'acqua, e quindi il che si riverbera sulla stima del volume netto disponibile al deflusso, avrà questa caratteristica notevolmente diversa. Quindi, come vedete, il CAD number, questo metodo SCS, entra un po' più nel dettaglio per quanto riguarda la trasformazione a flussi deflussi, come abbiamo detto fino a questo momento. Then, up to now, we have, of course, detailed how we can define the net volume. So I repeat, the volume available to the runoff in a very general framework, we start from the return period. We use observations in order to get the parameter of the so-called design rainfall, or with another word, the intensity duration frequency curve. And from this, we need to define the water discharge, actually the maximum value of the water discharge, that is equal to the net volume over a time. The net volume can be estimated with the methods that we described very synthetically here, and that we faced the last time. Now we need to understand the selection of the time. Pay attention that this is not the time. This is not a time, but this is a duration of the rainfall. This is a time instead. So we need to start from an information about the duration of the rainfall, and here we need to define the time needed to estimate the water discharge value. So we need to describe from a physical point of view what it is happening when it rains on a watershed. So, watershed. Actually, in English, this can be also called catchment. So what happens when it rains on a watershed? Let's try to describe from a qualitative point of view, of course, what did happen. So you can think that a droplet of water, so you can think that a small volume of water falls on to the watershed, in particular in a point of the watershed. We can define the location of this point by means of its coordinates within the frame, by using this reference frame. Then this A portion of this volume of water is lost because some of this volume infiltrates into the soil, a portion of this volume returns to the atmosphere, and then only a portion that we can call a kind of Vn start to flow. So start to flow up to the river. And then comes to the downstream section. So this is the downstream section. So you can realize that if this volume arrives into this point, at the time we can say it T1, the net volume, so a portion of this total volume, reaches the downstream section not at T1, but at T1 plus delta T. Now, if we pay attention to another point, we can write it defined as a point with a different location. Again, only a portion of the vo total volume starts to flow, then comes to the network, the hydrologic network, and comes here, say it at the same instant. So the total volume reaches the location X star, Y star at the time T1, but at the same instant, another water droplet reaches the point X2, Y2. Then this droplet, in general, reaches this point, the downstream section, in a different time. We can write this one and this one delta T star. So you can realize that in general delta T is a function of the x, y. So the longer the distance the water volume need to travel to reach the downstream section, the higher the value of the time, the higher the value of the time needed to reach the downstream section. So we can realize that not all the volume that falls into the watershed reaches the downstream section at the same time. So we can depict a kind of temporal axis. Pay attention. Now this is the time, not the duration. And here we can write the net volume, but also the water discharge. So somewhere, say it at this point, we can identify, we can depict the kind of value of the rainfall depth per unit area times the area we are looking at. So more or less this is a kind of rainfall depth. After a time, with a certain delay, that we can call delta t, this rainfall depth is transformed in runoff. So this is the rainfall, and this is the runoff, but not everywhere, at the downstream section, And this is true for, just for example, x star, y star. Now, if we take into account the same plot, just for example, the same rainfall depth, exactly the same. So this one and this one are exactly the same. This one is T1 and this one is T1, but occurring in a different location, then the water discharge occurs in a different time. So this delta T is delta T2. So it is a problem because it seems that we cannot define a unique value of the time. Indeed, if we come back here, we need a value of the time. As delta t is a function of the location we are looking at, then it is not so simple to define the unique value of the delta t in order to define the maximum value of the water discharge. But we can try to depict again the watershed, to depict again the hydrologic network with its own water, and we can define a kind of portion of the watershed. Say it that here we have delta T1, and here, with another color, here we have the water discharge. Let's try to understand what happened to the water discharge. So try to imagine that a rainfall is occurring. So at t equal to 0, the rainfall starts. So at t equal to 0, it starts to rain. So it rains the whole watershed, not only here, but we can divide the whole watershed in this way. So here we have delta t equal to 1, delta t1, here we have delta t2, delta t3, delta t4, delta t5, and a very small portion here with delta t6. And we can try to depict here all this delta t. So this is delta t1, this is delta t2, this is delta t3, 4, 5, and 6. Okay? Then it starts to rain. After a time delta t1, all the water that fall into this area has reached this section. So we can define a kind of Q1. The water that has fallen here, sorry, I The water that is fallen here had no time to reach this section, so it is into the watershed, and this water has not the time to reach the downstream section. So we need to wait T32, that is the time needed to the water fallen into this area to reach this section, in order to have the same, to have this water drained by, or better, flowing through the downstream section. So actually, if we wait further up to delta T2, we have the water fallen here, so Q1 that flows through the downstream section, but also this water discharge, that is the water that has fallen here. Okay? So here we have also the contribution of this area. If we wait further, we have also that this area gives his contribution. So in delta at delta T3, the water discharge increases and increases and increases and increases up to the time in which the whole watershed contributes to the water discharge flowing at the downstream section. Up to this time, the water discharge remain constant. So, by means of a clear plot, we can say that there is a time that is delta T6, from which the water discharge is constant, and then the water discharge decreases. So at this time, the Qmax is reached. So I mean, we need a rainfall of duration delta T6 in order to have the maximum water discharge for the given rainfall depth. Indeed, the rainfall that starts from t equal to 0 has a total volume related to the duration of the event. So we are saying that if at t equal to 0 starts to rain, and the rainfall depth is constant over the time, then the maximum water discharge is reached after, if the rainfall event is long enough in order to make possible the contribution of the whole watershed. So we are using two main hypotheses. The first one is the rainfall is homogeneous. So I mean the rainfall does not depend on the point we are looking at. So the rainfall here is the same rainfall of another point. So the rainfall is constant over the whole watershed. On the other hand, the intensity is constant. Constant. So the water coming from the sky, the intensity of the rainfall is constant over the time. Pay attention, over the time, within the duration of the event. So if these two hypotheses apply, then we can say that we need to wait a time equal to delta tx in order to have the maximum value of the water discharge. I mean that t star is equal to delta tx. Of course, in the sketch, in the example that we are looking at. Now, try to think what is, from a physical point of view, delta t6. Delta t6 seems to be the time needed to a water volume that falls into the farthest location from the downstream section to reach the downstream section. So delta t6 is the time needed to a water droplet that has fallen in a point located very far from the downstream section, from an hydraulic point of view, to reach the downstream section. This delta t6 actually is called the concentration time. Concentration time. And we can write it as Tc. So the concentration time is the time needed to a water volume that has fallen in a point located far away from the downstream section to reach the downstream section. Now you can realize that this concentration times is a function of the characteristics of the features of the dam, of the watershed. Of course, is a function from a qualitative point of view, of course, of the slope of the watershed. Watershed. We can say the mean slope of the watershed. So, the steeper the watershed, the lower the time needed to the water to reach the downstream section. But also is a function, it should be a function, of the length of the river, or if you want, of the watershed. Of course, the longer the watershed, the higher the value of the time needed to reach the downstream section, of course. And in general, it could be also a function of the area of the watershed. So we can realize when the concentration time increases, if the slope decreases. So the steeper, or better, the milder the slope of the watershed, the higher the value of the concentration time. But also, the higher, this is L, this is slope, we can call it IA, so we can write here IA. So, the longer the travel of the path of the water volume need to travel, the higher, of course, is the concentration time is. So, the longer is this distance, the longer, the higher the value of this time, of the concentration time. And again, if we talk this one, the higher the extension of the watershed, the higher the the value of the concentration time. So we are saying that the concentration time is proportional to the area, the length over the slope more or less. So the higher the area, the higher the concentration time, the higher the length of the path the water need to travel, the higher the value of the concentration time. The higher the slope, the lower the value of the concentration time. Actually, a researcher, and his name is Giandotti, an Italian researcher, in 1940 proposed to estimate the value of the concentration time by means of this empirical formulation as 4 times the square root of the extension of the watershed plus 1.5 of the length over 0.8 the square root of a parameter of the a parameter of the watershed related to the slope. You can realize that this formulation is consistent to this relationship that we get by using qualitative reasoning about the physical phenomenon that is occurring. So at the concentration time increases if the extension and the length increase, and the concentration time increases if a number, a parameter related to the slope decreases. So if this one decreases, if the slope decreases, then the concentration time increases. Now, what is HM? HM is a kind of mean height of the watershed. Watershed. Now, we have a problem when we are called to estimate the mean height of the watershed. First of all, because we need to understand what is the mean height. The second problem is related to the method needed to estimate the mean height of the watershed. In order to do this, we can use a kind of plot of this kind. So we put in the ordinate of this reference frame the elevation and here the extension. So let's try to take into account again a watershed. Watershed. This is a watershed. Of course, if this is the downstream section and then we have the network, we can define, we can ask, of course, this is the lowest part of the watershed. Indeed, the water is able to outlet from this section. So here we have the lowest elevation of the watershed, of course. And somewhere we can define a kind of the highest elevation, the highest elevation. So we can make here, we can depict here the maximum elevation, we can call it zeta max, the maximum elevation within the watershed. When I say the maximum elevation, I'm talking about the elevation of the ground, of the topography. And here, the lowest elevation, we can call it zeta min. Zeta min. And then we can try to answer to this question. How large is the extension within the watershed that is located at a elevation higher than zeta mean. So, I repeat, how large is the extension of the watershed, of the portion of the watershed, located at an elevation higher than the minimum value of the lowest elevation? Of course, it is the total extension of the watershed. So the whole watershed is located at an elevation highest than zeta mean. If I ask you, which is the area of the watershed that is located at an elevation higher than the maximum elevation? Of course it is zero. Zero. We can define then a specific, a given zeta star, say it zeta star, in which this one is the portion of the whole watershed that is located at elevations higher than zeta star. So zeta star, this one, we can call it A star, that is the extension of the watershed that is located at a elevation higher than zeta star. So we can repeat this reasoning for other elevation. So if this is zeta tilde, this is zeta tilde, we can define the portion of the watershed that is located at an elevation higher than zeta tilde. So if this is A tilde, we can define A tilde here, and then we have another point. If we repeat this reasoning for a long series of the elevation, we can have a kind of curve that depends on the elevation of the watershed, of the ground elevation of the watershed. And we can build this curve by using, just for example, a digital elevation model, or what you want, of course, this is this point. And this curve is called the hypsographic curve. So if we have different watershed with different slope, we should have different hypsographic curve. Hypsographic curve. We can compute the mean value of this hypsograph. So in this way, this area is equal to this area. So if this is zeta mean times A dot is equal to the integral of zeta dA. So zeta dA is the area under this curve. This area should be equal to this area. So we can compute the value of zeta mean. So just to be clear, zeta mean is equal to 1 over the total area of the watershed times the integral, between zero and the total area of the watershed of the hypsographic curve. So this is the hypsographic curve. So if I have here the elevation, here the area, here we have the hypsographic curve, this is A dot, this is the integral of zeta h dA, so this is the hypsographic curve, h, this is the hypsographic curve. We can define by means of this relationship the mean value of the elevation within the watershed. This is, of course, the minimum value of the elevation within the watershed. This is defined as the mean height of the watershed, and this can be used in order to estimate this HM and then the concentration time. Of course, this relationship is valid for the area higher than 170 square kilometer, but for area lower than 70,000 of square kilometer. So this relationship, that is the most used empirical formulation for the concentration time, is valid for rather large watershed. For smaller watershed, for smaller catchment, we can use, so we can write here, TC times 4 square root of A plus 1.5 L 0.8 HM for A between this one, square kilometer, and this is proposed by Giandotti. But also we have a long series of empirical formulation for the estimation of the concentration time. Just for example, we can have another formulation that is valid for smaller watershed, in which the empirical formulation is more or less the same, but we have also these parameters that are related to the land use and hydrologic state, hydrologic classification of soil, more or less as the SCS method. In this case, this relationship is valid for relative small watershed, in which M and D are coefficients that can be obtained by means of tabular information. But also we can have another formulation, just to see some of them, that is this one, this is a dot. Here we have the hydrologic length over the square root of the slope, power 0.77. And this is true for very small catchment, and this was proposed by Kirpich. So we can have this, we can use this formulation, depending on the extension of the watershed, but actually we can have also other, I put here dots, because we have a long series of empirical formulation for the concentration time. In other words, if we recall that Q is equal to the net volume over T star, actually this is the concentration time. And this is the maximum value of the water discharge only if the rainfall is homogeneous, and if rainfall, or better, rainfall intensity is constant. So this is a really useful relationship because it is simple to use, but these two hypotheses must apply. The first one is that the rainfall is homogeneous, so the same rainfall depth is occurring along the whole, within the whole watershed. And the second one is the intensity of the rainfall is constant over the whole watershed. So, if we start from when is equal to phi v dot, or when is equal to v dot minus this one squared, v dot plus 0.8s with s equal to this one, 100 over cn minus 1, then with v dot equal to the rainfall depth of an event with duration equal to the concentration time times the area of the whole watershed, so we can define this, so we can compute this. Then we can select one of these two methods in order to have the net volume. Then we can use here the net volume in order to get the maximum value of the water discharge. Let's try. If we use the first method, this one is equal to phi h of given duration equal to the concentration time times a, the water discharge, that is equal to Vn over the concentration time, is equal to phi h of duration Tc over A over times A over Tc. Now, h of duration Tc is equal to A duration equal to the concentration time power n, not m, power n. But we can also define, if you remember, the mean, the average intensity during this rainfall. And the intensity, the average duration, the average intensity is equal to h tc over tc. If we can call this as the intensity related to a duration of the rainfall equal to the concentration time, we can observe that this one, this ratio, is equal to this ratio. So actually, a rough estimate of the maximum value of the water discharge is related, of course, to this coefficient, the runoff coefficient, times the average intensity of a of a rainfall event of duration equal to the concentration time times the extension of the extension of the watershed. So as you can realize, in order to estimate the maximum value of the water discharge, we need to know the water depth, or if you want, we need to know the intensity duration frequency curve. So, as you remember, we start from the latent period. We can build the intensity duration curve. So this is the duration, and we know that we can compute the intensity duration frequency curve, and this is related to the latent period. So this is the intensity duration frequency curve. Intensity duration is clear. Intensity duration. Frequency, because this curve is related to this latent period. So we can now compute Tc, just for example, 4 times the square root of A plus 1.5 L 0.8 the square root of the mean height of the watershed. Then, just for example, if this is Tc, we can have Ec. Then the Q max is equal to phi, this value Ec, times A. So we have translated, if you want, we have transformed an information about rainfall to an information about the maximum value of the water discharge. Okay? So we need to start from a latent period. We need to perform the statistical analysis, analysis in order to get the correct parameters of the intensity duration frequency curve that I remember is equal to A duration n minus 1. This is A and n are the results of the statistical analysis. Then we need to use an empirical formulation for the estimation of the concentration time. Then we use the intensity duration frequency in order to get the value of the intensity related to the concentration time in order to get the value of the maximum water discharge. And this is the design law. At the very end, we got the value of the design load. If you remember, just a reminder, we need to design a hydraulic structure of a Q star or a wave height star. I mean, we need a value, Q star, but also a probability that Q is lower or at least equal to Q star. I mean, we need to the latent period. So what we do? We start from the latent period. We go to the probability, the non-exceedance probability, and we should go to the water discharge. But we cannot. So on the way, we need to use the information about the rainfall depth. So as you can realize, we have reached the goal of all these operations. We started from the latent period. By means of a statistical analysis, we get the rainfall depth related to this latent period, and then we are able to compute the Q star by using the, in this case, the kinematic method or the rational method. If we come back, you can realize that all this reasoning starts from this one. So coming back is valid in this case. But in this case, the reasoning is exactly the same. We need to compute V dot as the rainfall depth for a duration equal to the concentration time times the area of the watershed. We compute S, then we compute Vn, then we can have the maximum value of the water discharge. Now, the way an observation can be drawn by looking at this relationship that, I remember, I underline again, is valid only if the rainfall is constant or actually homogeneous and is constant. Intensity is constant. And this hypothesis not always, always can be accepted, can apply. Then we need to understand if we are able to remove both of them, or at least one of them. I can say that in order to remove this hypothesis, this one, we can again resort to a kind of theoretical method. I mean, these are theoretical methods, but they are able to provide us with a practical formulation needed to estimate the maximum value of the water discharge. If this hypothesis apply, if one of these hypotheses, if we want to remove one of these hypotheses, I can say that by removing this second one, we can continue to use a kind of method that we need to describe. If we want to remove both of them, we need to resort to numerical methods. So if we remove only this one, we can resort to the linear system theory. So we can apply a theory related to linear systems in order to understand what happens if this hypothesis falls, is not valid, cannot be accepted. If we want to remove also this one, so the rainfall is not constant, is not homogeneous on the whole watershed, I mean when the watershed is so large that the rainfall does not occur at the same time on the whole extension of the watershed, then we need to resort to numerical methods. Actually, in this course, we will describe these methods, and also we will apply a numerical method. Actually, we will use a numerical model that is called HMF. So this is a numerical method, just for example, one of the large number of numerical models that is able to tackle this problem, that is able to remove these two hypotheses in order to get the value, the maximum value of the water discharge. But from a theoretical point of view, in order to understand what these numerical methods perform, then we need to describe the linear system theory in order to get the value of the water discharge when the hypothesis of constant intensity is removed. You can realize that in this case, the maximum value of the water discharge is not identified directly, but we need, first of all, perform an estimation of the hydrograph, of the wall hydrograph. And then we can extract the maximum value. So if we remove this hypothesis, we need to reconstruct the time variation of the water discharge and then to extract the maximum value of the water discharge. That is our design load again. Now, before to stop, I repeat something in Italian. Quindi torniamo qui. Vediamo un po', in maniera molto molto sintetica, sperando che abbiate seguito un po' tutto, è che la portata massima, passiamo da qui, ok, può essere calcolata come il coefficiente di deflusso, utilizzando il metodo del coefficiente di deflusso, che moltiplica l'intensità media relativa ad un evento che ha una portata pari al tempo di coltivazione. Concentration time tradotto come tempo di coltivazione. Quindi questa è l'intensità media di un evento che ha una durata pari al tempo di coltivazione. Tempo di coltivazione che può essere stimato, ad esempio, per bacini abbastanza grandi con la forma di Giandotti. Quindi vi serve l'area, vi serve la lunghezza che viene chiamata lunghezza idrologica, praticamente è una stima dello spazio che deve percorrere l'acqua per arrivare nella sezione di chiusura, la sezione di valle, è un'altezza media che può essere definita sulla base della curva ipsografica. Che cos'è la curva ipsografica, se andiamo qui? È il luogo dei punti. Se io prendo un punto sulla curva ipsografica, vi sto dicendo qual è l'area, chiamiamola così, asteriscato, che è tutta al di sopra di una quota z asteriscato. Ovviamente nessuna area ha una quota superiore al valore massimo della quota, e tutto il bacino, cioè A tot, ha una quota superiore al valore più piccolo dell'elevazione, che è quella della sezione di misura. Quindi in linea generale questa curva vi dice come sono distribuite le elevazioni del terreno all'interno di un bacino idrografico. E quindi se voi calcolate la media di questa curva, intesa come media integrale, la differenza tra la quota media e la quota della sezione di chiusura è definita come altezza media che vi serve per calcolare il tempo di coltivazione. Ora, questo tempo di coltivazione da dove viene fuori dal punto di vista concettuale? Viene fuori dall'osservazione, vediamo un po' se riprendiamo. Viene fuori dall'osservazione, che riprendo dallo schema che abbiamo visto qui, che immaginatevi una pioggia che interessa l'intero bacino idrografico. Quindi immaginate, piove a partire da t uguale 0 su tutto quanto il bacino idrografico in maniera del tutto omogenea. Cioè la stessa quantità di pioggia cade in ogni punto. Tra l'altro cade anche con un'intensità costante. Cioè non è una pioggia, tra virgolette, vera. Una pioggia che inizia con una certa intensità e questa intensità rimane costante. Ora, l'acqua che cade vicino alla sezione di chiusura arriverà prima alla sezione di chiusura, se ci pensate. L'acqua che cade più lontana dalla sezione di chiusura ci metterà più tempo. Quindi vuol dire che se continua a piovere ci vorrà del tempo affinché l'acqua caduta su tutto quanto il bacino arrivi sulla sezione di chiusura, in corrispondenza alla sezione di chiusura. Quindi se identifichiamo in questo delta T6, come l'avevo chiamato qui, il tempo che l'acqua che cade idraulicamente più lontano dalla sezione di chiusura impiega per arrivare alla sezione di chiusura, Vi sto dicendo che devo attendere proprio quel delta T6 affinché la portata in corrispondenza alla sezione di chiusura raggiunga il suo massimo. Quindi, se io avessi una stima del delta T6, avrei una stima della durata dell'evento che mi permette di arrivare alla massi al massimo valore della portata in corrispondenza alla sezione di chiusura. Questo è vero ovviamente soltanto se la pioggia è omogenea e se l'intensità è costante, non in altre condizioni, soltanto se queste due ipotesi sono rispettate. Ora, quel delta T6 è chiamato tempo di coltivazione del bacino, quindi è il tempo che la goccia che cade nel punto idraulicamente più lontano dalla sezione di chiusura è il tempo che quella goccia impiega per arrivare alla sezione di chiusura. E questa, come abbiamo visto, si può stimare con una delle tante formule che abbiamo visto, la formula di Ciandotti, la formula di Kirpich e così via. Quindi, nella sostanza, vi sto dicendo che questa formulazione, che è chiamata formula razionale o metodo cinematico, nella sostanza è valido soltanto per pioggia omogenea e intensità costante, quindi una pioggia, se volete, piuttosto astratta. Quindi potrebbe valere la pena cercare di capire se si possono rimuovere queste ipotesi, almeno una. E vi posso dire che la seconda, quella identificata in rosso, cioè che l'intensità sia costante, può essere rimossa e possiamo continuare ad ottenere delle formulazioni empiriche piuttosto semplici da usare. E dobbiamo, tra virgolette, utilizzare la teoria dei sistemi lineari. Dall'altra parte, se vogliamo rimuovere anche l'altra, non c'è storia, dobbiamo risolvere numericamente il problema. E vi ho fatto l'esempio di un modello numerico che si chiama ECHMS, che vedremo, e che può darci una mano a rimuovere anche l'ulteriore ipotesi. Quindi, come vedete, siamo partiti da una situazione molto semplice. La situazione molto semplice vuol dire pioggia costante e omogenea su tutto il bacino. Nonostante queste ipotesi, abbiamo ottenuto una formula piuttosto comoda, perché è un numero moltiplicato un altro numero moltiplicato un altro numero. Primo numero è φ, coefficiente di deflusso. Secondo numero è l'intensità dell'evento di pioggia di durata pari al tempo di coltivazione. Il terzo è l'area. Potremmo stare qui a disquisire sul fatto che l'area di un bacino la stima dell'area di un bacino è complicata perché devo delineare il bacino, ma comunque in qualche maniera riusciamo a farlo. Quindi questa formula è vero che è semplificata, vale per quelle ipotesi, ma se ci pensate è piuttosto potente perché possiamo usarla in una maniera semplice. Quindi una prima stima, seppur grossolana, ce l'abbiamo. Addirittura possiamo rimuovere una delle ipotesi, che è quella di intensità non costante, ma nel momento in cui l'intensità non è costante, vuol dire che dobbiamo mettere in campo il tempo e quindi, invece che avere una stima diretta della portata massima, dobbiamo ricostruire prima l'idrogramma, l'idrograph. E quindi, una volta ricostruito l'idrogramma, possiamo identificare qual è il valore maggiore e il valore massimo della portata. Quindi diciamo che dobbiamo ragionare in maniera un po' più di dettaglio se vogliamo rimuovere semplicemente questa ipotesi che è quella che abbiamo segnato qui in rosso. Procedo? Procedo. Ok, perfetto. So, we need to define the instantaneous intensity. So, as you can realize, we are talking not of the average intensity, the capital I that we used up to now, but the instantaneous intensity. And from the instantaneous intensity, we need to get some information about the hydrograph, so the instantaneous water discharge, if you want, water discharge. And then we need to get the maximum value of the water discharge, or if needed, directly the hydrograph. So we need to start to the intensity as a function of the time. So just for example, we can have this one, and this is the duration of the event. So now the rainfall is not characterized only by its average intensity, but also by its instantaneous intensity. And from this information, we need to understand how the water discharge changes with time, and then we need to get the maximum value. So we need to start from the so-called diatograph, and then transform the diatograph in hydrograph, and then we need to get the maximum value of the water discharge. So first of all, we need to understand what we intend for diatograph. So let's start from the intensity duration frequency hydrograph curve. So here is TD, the duration. Pay attention, when we use a pedis D, we are looking at, we are talking about duration of the event, not the time. So here we have said that the intensity, the average intensity, decreases as the duration of the entity, the duration of the event increases. And this relationship is can be written as a parameter A, duration power n minus 1, where A and n comes from the results of the statistical analysis. Now, if we look at the instantaneous intensity, we need to switch to another reference frame in which, on the abscissa, we put the time, not the duration. So, when the instantaneous intensity is constant, we have a constant intensity starting from the beginning of the event up to the duration of the event. So this one. Now, as the intensity is constant, and the intensity, the instantaneous intensity, is equal to the time derivative of the rainfall depth, pay attention, again, this is the time derivative, not the derivative with respect to the time duration. So this is a lowercase I, not an uppercase I. So we use a capital I to refer to the average intensity, and a lowercase I to refer to the instantaneous intensity. Now, if this is true, we can obtain that the total rainfall depth that is related to an event with a given diatograph, say it I tau, the integral of the diatograph along the time from zero up the duration of the event is equal to the total rainfall depth related to that event. So I'm saying that if here I use a lowercase I, instantaneous intensity, this is the time, this is the constant intensity, the integral of the instantaneous intensity over the time is equal to h. Now the integral is the extension of this area, of course. This area is the integral from 0 up to td star, where td star is the duration of the event we are looking at, I tau, d tau, and this is equal to h, but h come from a t d star power n. Indeed, the design rainfall relationship, this h equal a t d power n, is aimed to estimate the total rainfall depth during the event. So we are saying that a t d star power n, this one, is equal to this integral. If we use I0, this area is equal to I0 time td. This is the area, the hatched area here. Then I0 is equal to a td star n over td, and this is equal to the, of course, the average intensity for the given duration event. So I mean, this I0 for td star is equal, if this is td star, to this intensity. This is I td star. So when we consider a iatrograph with constant instantaneous intensity, we are looking at an event with an intensity that does not change with time, equal to the average intensity that we can get from the IDF curve. So it is not so complex to identify the mean, or better, the constant instantaneous intensity that is equal to the average intensity, of course. Now, actually, a real event, a real rainfall event, can be depicted in this way. At the end of the rainfall, the intensity starts from zero and increase, and then decrease. Again, this area is equal to, of course, this is the end of the event, the integral between 0 and td star of e I tau d tau is equal to h of given td star. So it is true that we cannot estimate this area without to know the iatrograph, but we are sure that the area below this curve, below the iatrograph, must be equal to h that is given, h at td star is given by our rainfall, design rainfall. TT star, of course. So the diatograph is has its own shape, but the area is given by the design rainfall. So usually we can, at the design stage, we can define a series of simplified diatograph. Just for example, we know that at the starting, at the yielding stage of the of a rainfall event, the intensity does not change abruptly, sharply from zero up to a finite number, and then it is constant. We know that the intensity, the instantaneous intensity, first grows and then decreases. So this is the so-called triangular diatograph. Now, we know that the area below this curve is equal to h of this given TD star. This is h star. So we are saying that h star, that is equal to a TD star power n, is equal to the integral from 0 to TD star of I tau d tau. That is the area below this curve. Now, if this is I max, the maximum value of the instantaneous intensity, the area, this area, is equal to the area of this triangle, that is equal to the base TD star times the 8 I max over 2. Okay? So we can get that A TD star n minus 1, n power n is equal to TD star times I max over 2. Then we can have that I max is equal to A TD star over T power n, of course, over TD star times 2. That is equal, as this is the average intensity, for the given duration of TD star, we can get that Imax is twice the intensity of a rectangular diatograph. Indeed, this one is called rectangular diatograph. Okay, so when we look at the real, or at least a more realistic diatograph, we can observe that the maximum value of the instantaneous intensity is larger, is greater than the mean, the average intensity of a rectangular diatograph. Indeed, if we depict the rectangular diatograph, we can have something like that. So there is a time span here during which the intensity is higher than the rectangular diatograph. And we can realize, we can imagine that the induced water discharge is higher than the water discharge related to a rectangular diatograph. Now we need also another aspect. Indeed, we can define a continuous iatrograph. So this one. But actually, we can define also a discrete iatrograph. So we can divide the time in a series of delta t, during which the instantaneous intensity is constant. So whatever the iatrograph you want can be described as a succession of a series of rectangular iatrographs. So during this one we have a given rainfall depth R1, and in the second delta T a rectangular iatrograph during which we have a rainfall depth equal to R2. So if this is I1, this is I2, this is I3, Rm is equal to Im, so the intensity of the given delta T, times delta T. And we know that the summation over the whole event, so the summation of Rm, is equal to HTd star. So here we have the integral I tau d tau between 0 and Td star. Well, this is Td star. Here we can discretize the time with a series of rectangular iatrograph of duration delta t, and we know that this integral can be written as a summation of the water of the rainfall depth occurring during each delta t. So this is more or less the same, but here we are in the continuous world, continuous. Here we are in the discretized world. Then here the concept is the same. Here we have a continuous line. Here we have a succession of rectangular iatrograph, but the aim is the same. Here we use integrals, here we use summation. Now, say that we need to understand how this event, or better, how the rainfall depth related to this event can be is transformed in a runoff. I mean, in a water discharge. This is the question, more or less. And then we need to understand what it happens when a rainfall event occurs. Let's start by taking into account a particular kind of rainfall event. So as you can realize, this is the time, not the duration. And here we write the instantaneous intensity. We can take into account a particular kind of event, that is an event with very, 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 very small duration. Instantaneous rainfall. So we are talking about of a rainfall event with a very, very small duration. The duration is so small that we call this rainfall as instantaneous rainfall. This function E, as a function of the time, can be written as a special function that is called the Dirac function. This is a well-known function that is very useful when we talk about instantaneous phenomenon. So you can realize that the duration is very, very small, but the integral of the intensity, the instantaneous intensity, between zero and infinity, say it infinity, a very large time, that is equal to the delta we can use instead of tau, we can use here dt, that is equal to dt is equal to 1. So we are adding an information. First, the rainfall is very, very short. Indeed, it is instantaneous, but also it is unit. So the total rainfall depth that falls during this event is equal to 1 millimeter. So not only the rainfall is instantaneous, but also the total rainfall depth occurring during this event is equal to 1. This is a property of the Dirac function, but from a physical point of view, the property of the Dirac function actually can be expressed in a physical way. So we are talking about of a rainfall that is instantaneous, and the total rainfall depth is equal to 1, of course, millimeter in this case. Following this, due to this rainfall, that is quite strange, but it is an abstraction for now, we can observe that the water discharge can be something like that. We can call it a function that we call U of the time. So from this is the rainfall, to this is the runoff. Between them, we have the effect of the watershed. So this is the result of the action of the watershed applied to the rainfall. So the unit instantaneous rainfall occurs, the watershed acts on the rainfall, and then the response of the watershed can be written as a function of the time. Okay? So how the rainfall is transformed in a runoff depends on the feature of the watershed. This is the main rationale of this method, the method we are describing. So we don't know how this relationship is, but we know that the watershed acts on the rainfall, and the response of the watershed from this rainfall is provided by this function, that is a function of the time. Now, if the rainfall, instead to occur at t equal to 0, occurs just for example here at t, we can call it tau, at this instant tau. Of course, this is again e dt is equal to the Dirac t minus tau, because it occurs at tau. Okay, then the response of the watershed is more or less the same, because the rainfall is the same. The only difference is the time at which the rainfall occurs. Then the response of the watershed is equal, but with a delay. So this is equal to U T minus tau. So is as we define a new starting point. The starting point is where T equal to tau, so T prime is equal to T minus tau, if this is T prime, this is equal to the total time, this is the total time, minus tau, so this is delta T prime, and this is equal to U T prime. So if the rainfall occurs in a delayed time, say it tau, the response of the watershed is exactly the same, the only difference that is delayed, of course. Quindi, se io prendo in considerazione una pioggia istantanea ed unitaria, che viene descritta con questa funzione speciale che si chiama delta di Dirac, in qualche maniera il bacino idrografico trasforma questa pioggia in un deflusso. Per il momento facciamo finta di chiamarlo, ma non di conoscerlo. Cioè, nel senso, sappiamo che il bacino trasforma la pioggia in qualche maniera, e questa maniera è UDT. Facciamo finta di conoscere questa UDT, e infatti la disegniamo. Se questa pioggia, identica a se stessa, cioè istantanea ed unitaria, avviene un po' più tardi, non c'è nessun motivo perché la risposta sia diversa. La risposta è uguale, l'unica differenza è che accade un po' più tardi. Infatti, se definiamo un nuovo asse temporale, che invece che partire da qui, parte da qui, quindi definiamo un nuovo asse temporale T', in realtà la risposta è identica, soltanto che è scritto nell'asse temporale che non parte da qui, da questo istante, ma parte da questo istante. Quindi, nella sostanza, quando noi spostiamo, ritardiamo la pioggia, ritardiamo anche la risposta. E per questo concetto di ritardare vuol dire utilizzare, invece di solo t, t meno il ritardo. Quindi la pioggia diventa un delta, la stessa funzione di prima, di t meno tau. La risposta è la stessa risposta di prima, u, t meno tau. Ok? Quindi possiamo in linea di principio conoscere la risposta a qualsiasi dietogramma di quel tipo che avviene in istanti diversi. Now, we can observe that if E dt is equal to delta t meno tau minus tau, so this is the rainfall, the runoff qt is equal to ut minus tau. Now, if we change a little bit the iatrograph, and instead of having a unit instantaneous rainfall, we take into account a given quantity of, we can call it R1, delta T t minus tau, then q di t is, it can be written as hal 1 u t minus tau. So we are saying that if the iatrograph is related to 1 millimeter of total rainfall depth, the response of the watershed is this one, the instantaneous response function, this is called in this way. If we have not a unit rainfall depth, but a rainfall depth equal to R1, but occurring with a very short duration, so the rainfall is again instantaneous, the runoff is equal to the same response, instantaneous response function, multiplied the proportionality coefficient. So we are using a kind of principle of proportionality. And this principle is valid only for linear systems. But also we can take into account to another kind of ET that is equal to R1 delta T minus tau 1 plus R2 delta T minus tau 2. So two different instantaneous rainfall. So we are saying that here this is the iatrograph, this is the time. At the time tau 1, we have a instantaneous rainfall, but we have also another one at T2. The response can be written as R1, the instantaneous response function, written to T minus tau 1 plus R2 U T minus tau 2. And this is the principle of effects superposition, that is again valid only if the system is linear. Now, if we have a given iatrograph, this one, this is the time, and this is a kind of function, so this is ft. This can be seen as a succession of delta di Dirac, so a Dirac function with a given intensity. So in this case, with another color, in this case the iatrograph is a given function, then the response is equal to the integral from 0 to t of the function t time, the function of tau times the instantaneous response function of t minus tau, the tau. So we can, here we are using both the principles. The first one is the proportionality. Indeed, we multiply this one times this one, that is the function, that is this one. And the integral is the superposition. So we are using both the principles. And this integral is called the convolution integral. So what we are saying, We are saying that the response to whatever the heterograph, say it I tau, can be computed if the instantaneous response function t minus tau is known. So if this is known, instantaneous response function, and if the heterograph is given, then we can compute the water discharge. So we are saying, if we have whatever you want, whatever the heterograph you want, we can compute the response of the Delanoff related to this one. That is exactly what we want. We want to start from a heterograph, and we want to get information about the hydrograph in order to get this one. Where is the problem? The problem is that here we have an integral, and here we have an unknown function. So we have two problems. The first one is to compute the integration. The second one is to identify the instantaneous response function. First of all, let's try to approximate the integral. As you know, we can start from the integral, this one, t minus tau d tau. We can, in general, usually, what we do is to write the integral as a summation. So, a summation, say it over n, e tau n, u t minus tau, let's see, m tau m, times delta t. So what we are saying? We are saying that the heterograph instead is approximated by means of a kind of mean intensity during a given delta t, that is this one. Or better, we can call it delta tau. So this is delta tau. So, first of all, we discretize the heterograph in this way. And then we get this one. I tie tau m delta tau is the total rainfall depth during one of these delta t. So we can write in general, write that Qt is equal to the summation of the rainfall depth during the one of these rectangular heterograph times the instantaneous response function of t minus tau m. But here we have a problem, because it seems that we are using the principle of the proportionality. But this one is not the response to a finite rainfall. Indeed, each of these one is not instantaneous, but finite duration impulse. So this is a finite duration impulse of rainfall. But this one is not the response to a finite duration rainfall, but it is the response to an instantaneous rainfall. So this is not true. We need to use the response function to a finite duration rainfall. So instead of using the rainfall, or better, here we have instantaneous, and then we have the response that is U of t minus tau, we need to understand which is the response to a finite duration rainfall. So we have this one, and in general this one is not the same, just to understand it depends from this delta tau. So this one we can call this as ut minus tau. So we need to switch to the instantaneous unit response function to the response function to a finite duration rainfall impulse. So we need to remove the word instantaneous. So we need to understand which is the unit response function. So let's try to understand what we intend for finite duration impulse. So we need to switch to the real world if you want. So this is the time, and this is the rainfall. During this rainfall, we have a rainfall depth equal to 1 millimeter, just for example. Then the intensity is equal to 1 over delta tau, as this one is delta tau. So we are sure that during this event, that is a kind of rectangular diatograph with duration equal to delta tau, in order to have a unit rainfall depth, the intensity, the constant intensity of course, is equal to 1 over delta tau. Indeed, R is equal, in this case R1, is equal to the integral of E tau d tau, that is equal to, the intensity is constant, so the intensity is equal to 1 over delta tau. This one is the duration, that is delta tau, that is equal to 1. So in this case we are looking at a rainfall of finite duration during which the rainfall depth is equal to 1. Now this rainfall can be written as the difference of a iatrograph that is this one, with this one equal to 1 over delta tau, minus another iatrograph T that starting from this point, this instant, starts with a constant intensity equal to 1 over delta T. So if we have 0 minus 0 is 0. 1 over delta tau minus 0 is equal to 1 over delta tau. 1 minus 1 is equal to 0. So, if we can get the response to this one and this one, the difference of the response is the response to this diagram. We are using the principle of the superposition of the effect. I switch to Italian. Allora, in linea del tutto generale, possiamo arrivare a dire che la risposta, cioè la portata che deriva da un qualsiasi diagramma, può essere scritta in funzione di quella che viene chiamata la funzione di risposta istantanea. Cos'è la funzione di risposta istantanea? Immaginatevi una pioggia molto molto breve, molto molto breve, durante il quale cade un millimetro di pioggia. In qualche maniera il bacino idrografico trasforma quella pioggia in una portata. Siccome la pioggia è un po' particolare perché è istantanea ed unitaria, la risposta è una risposta a quel tipo di pioggia e quindi la chiamiamo risposta istantanea unitaria. Da una parte abbiamo, come dire, la forzante, la pioggia, dall'altra abbiamo la risposta. Ma se accettiamo di stare nel mondo dei sistemi lineari, possiamo utilizzare il principio di proporzionalità e di sovrapposizione degli effetti. Per cui possiamo scrivere che la risposta a qualsiasi tipo di diagramma può essere scritta in funzione di quella funzione di risposta istantanea, facendo quell'integrale i di tau, u di t meno tau in d tau, che viene chiamato integrale di convoluzione. Ora abbiamo due problemi. La prima è che dobbiamo conoscere quella funzione di risposta istantanea e poi dobbiamo calcolare l'integrale. Prima di tutto vediamo un po' cosa succede con il calcolare integrale. Lo possiamo trasformare in una sommatoria. E quindi quell'integrale, che vedete alla prima riga di questa lavagna, cioè questa, può essere descritta in termini di una sommatoria. Qual è il problema? Che io praticamente scrivo esattamente questo che vediamo qui sopra in termini discreti. I che accade al generico istante tau m moltiplicato u t meno quel tau m delta tau, che è il mio passo di discretizzazione. Quindi il mio ietogramma, o meglio, lo ietogramma continuo viene discretizzato come una successione di ietogrammi costanti. E vi accorgete che durante questi ietogrammi costanti cade una quantità di pioggia che è proprio uguale a quell'intensità moltiplicata delta tau. E quindi se andiamo avanti, questo è esattamente quello che avevamo visto prima. Cioè, risposta unitaria, istantanea, moltiplicata la quantità di pioggia che cade durante un evento di pioggia che però non è istantaneo. Quindi questa, diciamo, discretizzazione è concettualmente sbagliata. Perché è sbagliata? Perché non possiamo applicare la funzione di risposta ad uno ietogramma istantaneo ad uno ietogramma che non è istantaneo. Quindi invece di questa u piccola dobbiamo metterci una funzione di risposta allo ietogramma di durata finita. E questa risposta, invece che chiamarla con una U minuscola, la chiamiamo con una U maiuscola. Cioè, se qui, invece di metterci questa U piccola, ci mettessimo una U grande, allora quella relazione sarebbe perfetta, sarebbe corretta. Quindi, quel diverso, questo segno che ho messo qui, è legato all'utilizzo della U piccola. Però se noi riuscissimo a definire qual è l'idrogramma unitario, non istantaneo, ma unitario, riusciremo ad utilizzare questa relazione utilizzando invece di u piccolo u grande. E quindi abbiamo bisogno di capire che cos'è questo ietogramma di durata finita, di fatto un impulso di pioggia di durata finita pari a delta tau. Ancora una volta prendiamo in considerazione una pioggia durante il quale cade un'altezza pari a un millimetro, questo vuol dire intensità è uguale a 1 diviso delta tau. Ma questo impulso di pioggia può essere visto come la differenza di questi due ietogrammi un po' particolari, cioè uno ietogramma che parte da zero e poi ha un'intensità costante, meno un ietogramma che invece che partire da zero parte da delta tau con la stessa ietogramma, con la stessa intensità costante. Se voi fate la differenza di questi due, 0 meno 0 fa 0, 1 diviso delta t meno 0 fa 1 diviso delta tau, 1 diviso delta tau meno 0 fa 1 diviso delta tau, che è questa parte qui, 1 diviso delta tau meno 1 diviso delta tau fa 0. Quindi se riuscissimo a Capire qual è la risposta a questo primo ideogramma. Capire qual è la risposta a questo secondo ideogramma. Facciamo la differenza, quella è la risposta all'impulso di sopra. Stiamo utilizzando ancora una volta il principio di sovrapposizione degli effetti. Okay? So, if we call the response to this one as g dt, and this one as g dt minus delta tau, if we are able to compute this one, the response of this, the response of this will be equal as the difference of gt minus gt minus delta tau. We are using the principle of effects superposition. So we need to, first of all, to understand which is gdt. Then we need to write it as gdt minus delta tau, and then we need to put here in order to define the unit ideograph, the unit response function, without to be instantaneous. Then we take into account the first kind of ideograph. The first ideograph is this one, if this one. Is this one? So here we have 1 over delta tau. This one is called, is a particular function that is ht. Ht is the integral of delta tau d tau from 0 to t. Indeed, the integral of the Dirac function is equal to 1 if the delta function occurs within the integration interval. And this is called the Heaviside step function. So we have that E I t is equal to h t. Okay? Now we know that q t is equal to the integral of I tau u t minus tau t tau 0 t. This is the convolution integral, and this is true interval. Now, I d tau is equal to 1, of course. Then, this one is equal to 1 over delta tau, the integral between 0 and tau of u t minus tau tau. Indeed, I d tau is equal to 1 over delta tau. Then, we can write q dt is equal to 1 over delta tau, the integral between 0 and t, of u t minus tau d tau. Now we can write t prime as t minus tau. Okay? Then the t prime is equal to minus t tau. So we can write this integral in this way. I switch to another column. Q t is equal to 1 over delta tau, the integral, we need to write something here and here, of u t prime d tau is equal to minus dt primo, t prime, then we need a minus sign here. Then, here we are saying that tau is equal to 0, then t prime is equal to t. So this is t. When we are here, tau is equal to t, then t prime is equal to 0. Then this one We can invert the order of integration and we have 1 over delta tau over delta tau, the integral of 0 t u t prime dt prime. So we have discovered that this response function that is actually g dt, because this is g dt, because this is this function, it is the response to an Heaviside set function rainfall. And this is our first result. If we want to compute the same thing, but with an Heaviside step function starting from here, from delta tau, we have g t minus delta tau is equal to the integral, as you can realize here, not from 0 up to t, as we have here, but up to t minus delta t. So we have 0 t minus delta t, but the integrand is the same. So what we are saying, again, this is this one. We are saying that u dt that is equal to g t minus g t minus delta tau. So what we are writing here, the same thing that we have depicted in a graphical way here. The response of to this rainfall is the difference of the response to these two rainfalls. So we can write this one. The response to this rainfall is the difference between this rainfall minus a rainfall similar to the preceding, but starting at delta tau. Then u dt is equal to, we can use this one, so we can use this one, and then we have 1 over delta tau, the integral 0 t u t prime dt prime, minus 1 over delta tau, the integral between 0 and t minus delta tau u t prime dt prime. But we can use this one. Here we can switch the sign by switching the order. So we have t minus delta tau up to 0 u t prime dt prime plus, so this is 1 and this is this one, 0 t u t prime dt prime. So what we are saying that u t, that is the unit response function or unit hydrograph, what is equal to the integral. If we are looking here, this, here we have 0 and here we have 0, so this is a unique integral equal to the integral between t minus delta tau t of u t prime dt prime. So the unit response function is related to the instantaneous response function, but they are not the same. So in the convolution integral, qt equal to the summation over half m u t minus tau m. Not the so we need to use the unit response function, not the instantaneous response function. So now this is correct. Now this is correct. Now we need to understand how to use this one. So we can discretize the time with a parameter n. So the time n is equal to n delta tau. But we can also discretize the time at which the impulse of rainfall occurs. So we are saying that t iatrograph, here we have one impulse, here we have two impulses, here we have the third one. So this is m equal to 1, here we have m equal to 2, and here we have m equal to 3. So we are talking about that this m is the indices that we use to refer to the rainfall. Rainfall. Here we are using the n to refer to the time of the discharge. So if we want to use to write Tn, this one is equal to the summation from m equal to 1, the first one, up to the total number of rainfall impulses. So this is the total number of rainfall impulses. This one is equal if during this one a rainfall depth equal to R1 occurs, here R2, here R3, we need to write R m times u t minus tau m. Okay? Now t is equal to tn minus the instant at which the rainfall finished. So this is equal m delta t. Okay, delta tau, sorry. Delta tau. So as tn is equal to this one, we can write the q n delta tau is equal to the summation up to m equal to 1 to m of half m. Actually, we need to use the instant at which the impulse starts, not end, m minus 1. So we can write this as u of n delta tau minus m minus 1 delta tau. Then we have this one equal to the summation over m half m u n minus m plus 1 delta tau. So we can use as this parameter multiplies delta tau, these parameters multiply this one for delta tau. So we can use Qn, that is the water discharge occurring at the time equal to n times delta tau, is equal to the summation of L half m u n minus m plus 1 This is the discretized form of the convolution integral. Now, if we know the unit hydrograph, and I can say that we can know the unit hydrograph, we can use this relationship to get the response. Let's try. We can write. Let's the unit hydrograph. This one, we have delta tau. Here we have 2 delta tau. Here we have 3 delta tau, and so on. We can write, we can know in some way. And then here we have 0. So this is 1, U1. This is U2. This is U3. This is U4, U5, and U6. And the value of the unit hydrograph starting from this delta tau is equal to 0. So the response is basically finished. We can write Qn equal to the summation over m, L, m, U, n minus m plus 1. On the other hand, we can have the intensity, the iatrograph. Again, we need to separate delta tau, 2 delta tau, 3 delta tau. So we have the first impulse, the second one, the third one. So this is R1, R2, R3. Okay? So let's try n better. At the first time step, the first time step, t equal to delta tau, so I mean n equal to 1. Q1 is equal, let's try, m equal to 1, m equal to 2, m equal to 3, here. Yeah. So we need to write this summation for n equal to 1 and for m equal from 1 to 3. So we have the first term is L1, R1, times O, n is equal to 1. So we have 1 minus 1 is 0, plus 1 is 1, U1. So this one, this value. M2, the second impulse, does not occur yet, so it's enough. So we need to switch to the second one. So here we have n equal to 2, and we need to perform this summation. So the first term is for m equal to 1, so we have R1. N is equal to 2, so we have 2 minus 1 is 1. Plus 1 is 2. Now the second impulse is occurred. So we have R2 times U, n is equal to 2. So we have 2 minus 2 is 0, plus 1 is 1. The third one does not occur yet. So we have Q3. So we have the summation L1. U, we have here n equal to 3. We have 3 minus 1 is 2. 2 plus 1 is 3. 3. So this one plus R2, and n is equal to 3. 3 minus 2 is 1. 1 plus 1 is 2. And now the third impulse is occurred. So we have R3, U, n is equal to 3. 3 minus 3 plus 1. 3 minus 3 is 0, plus 1 is 1. Now the rainfall is finished, but the response is not. So we need to continue. So we have here n equal to 4. So we have R1, 4 minus 1 is 3, 3 plus 1 is 4, plus R2, 4 minus 2 is 2, 2 plus 1 is 3. 3 plus 4 minus 3 is 1, 1 plus 1 is 2. If we continue, we have this relationship, plus 3, E3. We can continue again. Q6 is equal to R1, U6, plus R2, U5, plus 3, R3, U4. Q7 is equal to R1, U7, but if we look here, 7 is equal to 0. So this one is 0, plus R2, that is the last one, 3, U5. Q8 is equal, this one also is equal to 0, plus R4, R3, U6. You can observe that the first column is the contribution of the first impulse of this one. The second column is the contribution of the second one. The third is the contribution of the third one. It is a kind of superposition of the effects, but also with the delay. Indeed, the third one starts from the n equal to 3, the second one from n equal to 2, and the first one from n equal to 1. So it is not a simple summation. It is a kind of summation with a delay.